Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Triangulation, episode 224, recorded Monday, November 9th, 2015. Ed Lucas, Cyberphobia. Triangulation is brought to you by Prosper. Prosper is a peer-to-peer lending marketplace that connects people who are looking to borrow money with those who have money to lend. Visit prosper.com/triangulation to apply for a loan now. And by Epson's new EcoTank printers. With Epson's line of super tank all-in-one printers, you can print thousands of documents without running out of ink. EcoTank is loaded and ready to print when you are. Visit Epson.com/EcoTank to find out more. And by Blue Apron. Blue Apron will send you all the ingredients to cook fresh, delicious meals with simple step-by-step instructions right to your door. See what's on the menu this week and get your first two meals free by going to blueapron.com/twit. That's blueapron.com/twit. Welcome to Triangulation, the show where we get to talk to some of the most interesting people in technology, pick their brains for an hour, give you a chance to talk to them too through our chat room. I'm very excited to talk to our guest today. Edward Lucas is a senior editor at The Economist, one of the best magazines in the world. He's been covering Eastern Europe since 1986, wrote a book called The New Cold War and Deception, the Untold Story of East-West Espionage Today. And he's joining us from London, where he is the author, by the way, of a new book called Cyberphobia. Mr. Lucas, thank you so much for joining us today.
It's great to be on the show. Hello. Yeah.
And I like the Schubert. Do you play that, or is that somebody else playing the piano behind you? I love that. One of the things about Skype that probably many of our guests are unused to is we can see everything.
I would love to say I just bought this background on the internet, and you can load anything you like on Skype as a background. So this, I could have mountains, books, make myself look studious, or an enormous collection of lethal weapons, or even a series of computer servers all blinking away to make me look as if I was a real geek.
No, I like the intellectual look. That's good. I think a nice choice.
Yeah, it was well worth it.
So how did you go from Eastern Europe and espionage to cyberphobia and cybersecurity? How did that happen?
Well, I've always been really interested in electronics and digital technology. I built a small primitive computer when I was a kid.
A Sinclair, probably, right?
No, this was just a circuit board with transistors that actually had...
even better.
It made a low sort of whistle, which occasionally would change frequency, though it was quite hard. This was back in about 1973, when you had transistors which were put on circuit boards with springs. But I made a few basic electronic devices. I had a Sinclair, and I had one of the first, a ZX Spectrum. One of the first. I had a Tandy laptop, if any of your viewers who are interested in industrial archaeology remember that, which was a solid-state computer.
The Model 100.
It was great. You actually used it as a verb. To Tandy meant to send stuff over something called a modem, which was very exciting those days. But the serious answer is that I'm very interested in security, and it seemed to me that we'd made the same mistake in dealing with Putin as we had with malefactors on the internet, that we had a rule-based international order which was based mainly on wishful thinking and assuming that everybody was like us. And it doesn't really work when you have people who think differently. So the internet was set up as a means for academic cooperation among people of trust and goodwill. It worked brilliantly for that. We never really thought about e-commerce or e-banking or that it was going to be used for commercial purposes. And in fact, we never really thought about security, and we still don't to a large extent. And it's a bit like that with Europe now, that we set up a post-Cold War security order in Europe, which is based on the idea that we were all on the same side. And unfortunately, with Putin, it turns out we're not all on the same side. And so that parallel's always been there in my mind. But the really brutal answer to your question is the publisher said, would you like to write a book about cybersecurity? And I said, how much? And he said, lots. And I said, fine. And 3 years later, here we are.
But couldn't be a more timely subject. In those 3 years, Edward Snowden informed us all that our nation states were spying on us. I know you've been very condemning of Snowden. In fact, you consider him perhaps a Russian spy.
I think he's either wittingly or unwittingly helping the Russians. I think the idea that espionage agencies engage in espionage is
what
about
a surprise!
His,
yeah,
it's, it, you know, bears defecating in woods, popes, Catholic faith, and so on. And I what I find really surprising is that the American system of intelligence oversight is actually the toughest in the world. We in Britain are stumbling towards something that might have the same sort of security oversight that yours has, with judicial warrants and with real legislative scrutiny. Most countries don't have that. So I was a bit surprised that this was held up as the epitome of evil, whereas I think many countries think it would be good if we could have a bit of that. But I'm happy to talk about Snowden at length, but the book really isn't about Snowden. It's about what I regard as the most serious thing, which is that we are hugely expanding our vulnerability to foreign spies, hooligans, criminals, pranksters, all the time. And the Internet of Things makes this is just a huge new facet of the threat surface. And this is developing far faster than our ability to protect ourselves. And I find that really worrying.
Do you see nation states as the bigger threat? You mentioned Russia and, of course, China, or is it private actors and frankly organized crime that is a bigger threat?
Well, I think it depends who you are, that the APTs, advanced persistent threats, are very high-end. They're like the nuclear submarines of the cyber world. They're very expensive and they're good at doing one thing, and they do that quite well. And that's going after high-end targets. So for most people, and a lot of the what I call Snowdenistas don't really realize this, the people who think the Bourne identity is a documentary and they're Jason Bourne, most governments have better things to do than to go after most people. They can if they need to. They have all sorts of capabilities. But for most of us, I'm much more worried about crime. I hate the word cyber, so I don't call it cybercrime, but crime where computers and networks are the means of the attack, because evolution hasn't really given us the sort of smarts we need to protect ourselves. I'm also worried about digital weapons as a means of warfare, because I think there's all sorts of scope for both for terrorists and hostile nation states to do nasty things to our infrastructure, either in sort of a terrorist kind or just pure sabotage. And again, we are very unprepared for this. A lot of the people who deal with shipping, for example, have absolutely no idea how vulnerable they are to a cyber attack against the way in which our ports operate. And that could cause enormous chaos and disruption.
We're talking to Edward Lucas, the author of a new book called Cyberphobia. Obviously, you did not choose that title, so we won't blame you for that.
No, I did, actually.
I thought you didn't like cyber.
I don't. It's the only place the word cyber appears is once in the on the cover, and once in the glossary, where I say people who use cyber usually indicate they don't know what they're talking about, and that's what the Greeks would call the I think Epidemius paradox, where yes. You say this man is a Cretan and he says all Cretans are liars. So I don't like cyber, but it's like many things in life, it's a kind of handy shorthand. But the rest of the book uses no jargon at all, and I try to use really simple language that ordinary people would speak and understand. Because I think one of the biggest problems we have is with this is that it's not really a technical problem. It's a problem about behavior. And to change behavior, you have to talk to people in language that they understand.
We're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll talk about that behavior and more about the book Cyberphobia, Identity, Trust, Security, and the Internet with our guest. It's author Edward Lucas. We're talking to Edward Lucas. He is a senior editor at The Economist and the author of Cyberphobia, until now covering Eastern Europe, quite the expert, really, in the threat that Russia poses all of the Western world and Eastern Europe in general, and the new Cold War. He's also written an e-book about Edward Snowden. But his latest, Cyberphobia, is we'll use an Americanism. You're Paul Revere saying, the bad guys are coming, the bad guys are coming.
That would be grotesquely flattering to me.
Even if you're a Brit, all right.
I'm not risking my life. Nobody's trying to shoot me.
Yeah.
But I think that that there is a problem here that people who are in the business understand quite well.
Yes.
That software is inherently unreliable. We don't have trustworthy software. Our hardware is full of holes. We have enormous legacy of stuff that has built up over the last 20 or 30 years, which people are still using. Even if we started tomorrow doing things right, it would be taking a long time to put put everything right. People who are also in the business also understand that the bad guys are getting much smarter. They have got have markets for malware. You can buy payload from one place, the breach from the other, command and control from somewhere else. So these are very substantial capabilities which are now available, and you can pay for them with Bitcoin, untraceable. You can get your revenues as a cyber criminal in Bitcoin. So there's a whole kind of dark economy out there, and it's developing very fast. And our institutions and habits are not really set up to deal with this. We don't have cross-border criminal justice cooperation. It works very, very poorly in most cases. We don't share threat sharing between businesses. Is very difficult. They don't want to publicise the fact that they've been breached. We have our identity assurance is very difficult. Most people still use passwords to try and prove who they are, and so at every stage our system is not really working. And meanwhile, the bad guys, whether they're spies, hooligans, pranksters, criminals, whoever, have got the upper hand.
Geez, that's depressing. You are talking, when you're on this network, to a sophisticated, technically literate group. We have a regular two-hour show every week on security that delves in great nuts and bolts details with this issue. So you probably are talking to that former group that kind of understands the threat. Sometimes I even think of some of our viewers as tinfoil hat paranoids. I mean, you can get over concern, but now you're starting to concern me. The thing I like about this book is it's full of incidents. It's full of stories about things that have actually happened.
Well, if you want to work for my publishers as the publicist, you'd be very welcome. Thank you for saying nice things about my
book. No, I love it. I mean, even go back to my friend Cliff Stoll and the Cuckoo's Egg. And,
yeah.
I mean, because it's easy to make these assertions. But what really makes them hit home is when you read over and over and over, this happened and this happened. And I think we, at this point, many of us are kind of numb to it. I was thinking about the recent case of hackers getting into the CIA director's email account. And it was minimally reported, especially by us, because it was like, yeah, well, so what? What's new?
Well, I think you've put your finger on one of the really important things, which is there have been so many breaches that people have become numb to them. And you read, company X has been breached, X million personal details have gone, and you think, well, now what? If it was a terrorist bomb, you'd say, and the building fell in, lots of people died, and
right.
We have a sort of idea.
Right.
This plane was shot down from the sky, and we have an idea about kinetic threats. But with these threats to our computers and networks, the payback isn't immediate. Now, and we have a real problem. 100 million Americans' healthcare data has been breached one way or another. That's immutable data. That is not something you can change. It's like your date of birth, your security number, all this sort of stuff. You can't, it's very hard. You can't get another date of birth. You can't get a mother's maiden name. You can't, very great difficulty when you get another social security number. So once they've got that, they've got it forever. And they can do stuff with that. They may not do it today or tomorrow or next week, but they can. And so this is a new kind of threat. But I was very pleased you mentioned Clifford Stoll. He was the guy who discovered the so-called Cuckoo's Egg breach back in the 80s. And this was one of the first real cyber attacks. That they didn't call it that then. And what's interesting is that the techniques the attackers used would still work. The techniques that he used to uncover those attackers probably wouldn't work these days. One of the things he did to track them down was to print out every single move they made on his network. He could do that because in those days you could have a dot matrix printer and it would just print away and you could have a complete record of what happened. That would be really difficult now. If you tried to print it out, you'd fill a room with the printout very quickly. When they got somewhere sensitive, he would jangle his keys across the computer, the terminal which had the wires on it, creating some static on the line, and they would think, oh, well, it's static, we didn't get there. These days you couldn't do that. So I think the defenders are actually worse off now than they were in the days of Cuckoo's Egg in some respects.
All right, so I think we can agree. We could stipulate things are bad and getting worse. Would you say the bad guys are gaining on us?
Absolutely. Yeah. I think that the dark economy is developing much faster than the defenders' economy. They can share ideas really quickly. We don't share information, they do. They have a very functioning market in malware. Our market in cybersecurity products doesn't work very well because it's mainly people who don't know what they're doing, selling to people who don't know what they're buying. I exaggerate only slightly, but it's a pretty bleak lookout. They don't need legal processes and institutions to do what they do. We are hamstrung by our idea of what a law-governed society should look like. And we are putting more and more stuff online. The Internet of Things is millions and millions and millions of devices, all of which are hooked up to the Internet for reasons of convenience and cost and all the rest of it. And you can blow things up by attacking them over Wi-Fi. And, you know, this, you know, the famous example here is the internet-enabled fridge. And you can blow up an internet-enabled fridge by switching it into maintenance mode and then back on and off again very quickly until, in the end, the compressor blows up. Now, if you're lucky, it just releases the gas into the atmosphere. If you're unlucky, maybe it'll catch fire. And you do that a lot, and things will catch fire, and that raises all sorts of questions. We have the insurance companies who insure the building where those devices are, the businesses which depend on them, you know, on them working and not spoiling the food. We are really dependent. Our real-life world is dependent on this stuff, and we're building more and more of it and putting it on the internet without necessarily thinking, you know, what are the vulnerabilities, or very importantly, can you fix stuff? Does this have the? Can you remotely update the firmware? I think it should be illegal to sell an internet-enabled device where you can't update the firmware remotely, because otherwise you're just stuck. It's in the wild, and someone will use it, and it can be... you know, be vulnerable and cause all sorts of damage.
We, well, in fact, with bad USB, we are surrounded by USB devices that cannot be updated, except that the bad guy can easily modify them. You say, though, this is not a book for the locksmith, and I'll take it that we're all locksmiths here, at least sophisticated enough to understand lock picking. This is a book for the general populace so that they better understand the threats they face.
Yes. I mean, lockpicking, I actually enjoy lockpicking. I'm not very good at it, but I can pick simple locks, and it's a sort of amusing party trick. Occasionally it can be useful if you lock yourself out of somewhere which doesn't have a very strong lock on it. But we tend to think about security in terms of locks and keys. And that is actually a little bit too easy, because when you use a password somewhere, and that's like leaving a copy of your key, or copy of, actually a better analogy would be leaving a copy of your credit card at every place you shop. And you're then dependent on the place where you use the password storing it correctly. And if they don't hash it and salt it and encrypt it and all, you know, do all the stuff they're meant to do, someone can break in there and steal your password and everybody else's, and then they can do stuff with that. And you know, we are used to the idea, I have my key and it's in my pocket, and you know, making a copy of it's quite difficult. Internet security isn't like that. It's much, much more difficult.
And there are issues about updatable firmware as well. You know, for instance, most routers have updatable firmware, but the companies just don't bother to fix anything. So it's more than just making it updatable, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, I think firmware is the one of the sort of big dirty secrets of the internet world, because we think, you know, have you updated your antivirus? Have you installed the latest operating system? Well, that's all fine. But you can have malware that sits around on the firmware.
Right.
And, you know, keyloggers is a classic example. If you can get a keylogger onto someone's keyboard and it lives on the chip in the keyboard...
No one will ever know. Yeah.
Well, you may find out, but too late. And what the solution to that probably is just throw away your keyboard. But if it's adaptive malware, it may be coming back in from somewhere else. And the people who make these devices didn't make them with security in mind. They made them with cost in mind, mainly, and plug and play and all the rest of it. So you you want something that when you buy it, it will work and you stick it in. And you don't, you know, there's no one sitting there saying, are all these computer peripherals being looked at from a security point of view? And the result is we've baked in millions of points of vulnerability all over our system.
I love the analogy, the anecdote you tell about Charlie Chaplin's movie, The Great Dictator, and Hitler banned it, but did obtain a copy, apparently watched it twice, and it made him cry. You point out that, if a North Korean dictator didn't like a movie, he would do more than cry, and in fact did.
It's very interesting, this. The hack on Sony was a really major breach, and I compare, if the Nazis had tried to get back at the studio which produced The Great Dictator because they didn't like it, what could they have done? Well, they could have bombed it, they could have burglarized it, broken in, they could have maybe, you know, with a really sophisticated burglary, they could have got in, maybe set fire to it, taken some files away. But it would have been very difficult. It would have been a major operation which would have had very high risk attack. Now, we don't know that the North Koreans actually hacked Sony Pictures Entertainment. They are the main suspect. But certainly they were able to do this remotely. unattributably. We still don't know who's them. They would do tremendous damage, stealing all the emails of all the chief executives and putting them online, stealing copies of pictures that hadn't been released, copies of scripts. Yeah, this was a far bigger attack launched by the putative North Koreans than the Nazis would ever been able to do against Charlie Chaplin.
Yeah. We'll have more with Edward Lucas in just a bit. But first, I want to talk a little bit about something the internet has brought us that is wonderful, magical, amazing. The alternative, the internet alternative to the bank loan. If you need a little money, you need it quickly, I want you to know about prosper.com. Do not borrow on your credit cards. That would be insane. Instead of getting stuck with high interest rate credit cards, go to prosper.com. It's an online marketplace that connects people who have money to lend with those who want to borrow. It's a great investment opportunity for people, and it's great for us because that means we can get up to $35,000 in as few as 5 days for a low fixed interest rate. Think of it as Airbnb or Uber for borrowing money. With Prosper.com, you can borrow money for just about anything you want, pay off those high-rate credit cards. That'd be a smart move. Fix up your house, even plan a vacation, start a business. Prosper.com, it's the better way to get the cash you need at a low, predictable, fixed rate. And you can find out what that rate would be, by the way. Just go to prosper.com/triangulation. It's a quick form, doesn't require a lot of information, and it will not affect your good credit. Prosper.com/triangulation for up to $35,000 in your account in as few as 5 days. Prosper.com/triangulation. We thank them for investing in our show. Our guest is Edward Lucas, new book, Cyberphobia, which is kind of, what's nice about this is it reads in many respects like a novel. It's gripping, it's exciting, and then it's all true. It maybe make it a little bit more scary than your average novel. Let's talk a little bit about identity, because that is, and it's one of the central parts of the book, and it's one of the central issues in security. And you mentioned, you know, this 100 million Americans whose identity essentially has been stolen. And irrevocably, what are we doing wrong, and how can we make that better?
Well, I think one of the problems is we've confused identity and access, and what you need to prove who you are shouldn't necessarily be your identity details, because if you use those to prove who you are and they get copied, then somebody else can then impersonate you. Yeah. So if I have your social security number and your address and a few other bits of information about you, I can start doing stuff in your name. I can apply for a driving license. I can get take out loans in your name. I can start pretending to be you. And if someone is driving around with a driving license that says they are Edward Lucas, what do I do about it? It's got my name, my date of birth, but it's some other guy. And that's, you know, that's our whole idea of one identity, one person, starts falling apart when you see how easy it is. I don't like to say to steal identities, because it's still my identity, even if, you know, you're using it, but to clone identities. Now, I'm a huge fan, I'm going to get it out of my pocket here because I meant to get it out earlier, of the Estonian system. The Estonia, which is a small...
You're an e-resident of Estonia. What does that mean?
Well, I'm going to show you. This is my e-resident. So first of all, well, here is a British driving license.
Okay.
Which I'm holding up.
Yeah, I don't know if you should show that. Oh my God! Okay,
it doesn't have anything on it. It's important. But, okay. That is.
I worry because remember we have smart people watching who will freeze frame and steal every bit of information on it.
Yeah, okay. But, I mean,
as long as you know.
Yes, I realize that. And that gives my address, which is public knowledge, and my date of birth, which can be worked out from the, if you can unscramble the
I just want to point out that your picture in the driver's license and your picture in the back of the book doesn't look at all like you. So I am. I hope I'm talking to Edward Lucas here, speaking of identity.
Well, it's. I can also, and what I could do if you...
Show
me
your identity card from Estonia.
So this is an Estonian digital ID card.
It's got a chip on it. Yeah,
it's got a chip. That's the whole point. It actually says for digital use only. I'm putting it right up close so you can see. Now, this is what I call my Estonian Express card. It does for my travel on the internet what American Express does for international travel. I have two PIN numbers with that, and I'm not going to tell you what they are because that could be handy to an attacker. One of the PIN numbers is used for proving who I am, and the other is for authenticating a decision. So if, for example, I want to send an email, I can send an email from edward.lucas@esti, which is Estonian in Estonian, .ee. And that comes with my ID card, which is plugged into a card reader on my computer. And that can only really come from me. It's very, very hard to spoof that. Maybe the NSA could do it, but it would be very, very, very difficult. It's 2048-bit encryption. I can send you a document, and this is the really interesting bit, that only you can read. These cards have public keys on them. So my public key is 36205030034. Anyone who knows that public key can send a document, and only I can read that, because I then put my card into the reader, type in my PIN number to show it's me, and then it will unlock.
Is it using PGP? Is it?
Don't know how technical you get. It's symmetric key encryption. It has a key which is stored on the card, and if I lose the card, that's it. Anything I've encrypted with the card, I can no longer read. Okay. If I've sent it to you, then maybe you'll be kind enough to decrypt it and send it back to me again. But there's a very the identity is based on the chip on the card.
I love it that they're doing this. This is amazing.
Yeah. It's a fantastic system, and you can. Anyone in the world can sign up for this. It costs $60-$70. You give a full biometric check to the Estonian official. So they do your retina, your fingerprints. They look at all your real-world documentation. So they are really sure to a very high degree of identity that's really you, which has the advantage that nobody else can then apply for that in your name. And then anywhere in the EU, 500 million people, single digital market, you can use that to sign documents, to verify your identity. You can use it for electronic banking. And it's far safer than all this nonsense of password and mother's maiden name and all this kind of hullabaloo that we fondly but wrongly believe gives us security in our digital lives.
Do I have to go to Estonia? I'm going to be in Tallinn next year. Should I get my card then?
No, do before then. You can go. If you can get it at the Estonian consulate, which is in, I think, San Francisco or maybe LA, or you can get it in New York, you can get it in Washington. So if there's an Estonian embassy or consulate or diplomatic mission anywhere in the EU, just turn up with all your there's a process. You just Google it and find out what to do. Or you can do it when you're in Tallinn, which is fine too. But once you've got that, you are then able to do stuff online that only Estonians can do. And in terms, you can prove who you are and you can check who other people are. And I think we've got three problems on the internet, but one of the fundamental ones is this identity assurance. How do I know who you are? How do you know who I am? And once we, because this basis of civilization really is individuals trusting each other, and because they trust each other, able to engage in productive interaction. And if I meet you face to face, I can touch you, look at you, smell you, listen to you. I get all five senses come into play, and I decide whether I trust you or not. On the internet, it boils down often to, you sent me an email, and do I trust that? So if only one of my senses, and that working only in kind of two dimensions and not moving. So what this does is substitutes for that. It gives you a strong digital basis for engaging with other people, and I really like that.
It's interesting that Estonia does this. You know, if we attempted to do a national identity card in the United States, there would be a hue and cry from privacy advocates. But I think if I join the Estonian government, I'm not too worried about Estonia. It's interesting. They have really pushed this whole idea. I remember meeting the Wi-Fi king of Estonia, or the Wi-Fi mayor of Estonia some years ago. They're very proud of this. And I think it's smart for a former Eastern Bloc nation trying to find its own way and to build its own economy to say, you know what, the future is digital.
I think Estonia is a terrific country. I mean, this is where we're talking on Skype. It's where Skype was invented. Right. I lived in Estonia. I ran a business there 20-something years ago.
Interesting.
I even speak a bit of Estonian. My first son was born there. And I think they've cracked something very important. Another very important thing is that you own your data in Estonia. Nobody else owns it. You give permission for anything that happens to it. So this whole idea in America that you can have data at some company holds, nonsense. You don't let anybody hold your data. Your data is your data. And you give permission for anybody to use it, and they don't get a copy of it. They just check that what you're asserting is true. So if I need to prove I'm over 21 in Estonia, I don't need to give my date of birth. I say I'm over 21, and then the guy who needs to check me has a computer which will check against wherever I'm registered. Is he over 21? They get back a yes or no. They didn't get my date of birth. Right. And this is a system called the X-ray. And it's in technical terms, it's a federative data interchange system. So you have lots and lots of databases. You don't have a single central database. You have lots of databases which then interact with each other when they need to. But they do it on not on the basis of exchanging the data, but on a challenge response. Is what this guy, is the answer to this question yes or no? Can I go ahead?
Why do they issue these to non-Estonians?
Because they are a small country and they need friends because they have a bad neighbor. Because they think it's good for Estonia. It creates what they call a digital diaspora of people who just kind of, once you've got one of these, you can set up a company in Estonia. You can do that online. You can bank in Estonia. You actually still have to go to Estonia to open the bank account, but they're working on it. Because, in fact, I should say, this whole thing's still in beta. It's one of the things I most like about this. They launched it and said, this is in beta. Lots of stuff isn't going to work, but we will only find out how to make it work when we've launched it. So I was number 0001. I got the first.
Oh, nice.
And I said, this is great. Okay, how do I make this work? I did it on one of their computers and did my first digital signature and a couple of other stuff. And then we drank a glass of champagne. And this proves how Estonia works. And I then said, how does this work on my MacBook Air? And they said, oh, it's really easy. Just stick the card reader. And I said, okay, just show me. They said, oh, hang on a moment. You're not running Yosemite, are you? And I said, yeah, I am. I just upgraded because it's when the Yosemite just came out. And they went, aha. I then had the four top geeks in Estonia. This would be like having the director of the NSA and the White House guy who does cyber and two other people all standing around my MacBook Air. I never seen anybody go so deep under the hood in a Mac. They went beyond terminal into kind of, real sort of geek stuff. And then after a bit, they said, right, this should work, but we may need to update it in a couple of months' time.
Wow.
But I thought this is great. In most countries, we don't do things until they work. With the result is everything's very slow and it still doesn't work. What they did was they said, let's just launch it and then work out how to fix it once we see what breaks it. And
that's so that was a very entrepreneurial attitude. I see on the website e-estonia.com if people want to know more.
That's the one. Yeah.
It's used for an ID, national ID, national health insurance card. You can use it to get on the bus. You can pick up your prescriptions. Yep. You can vote. It's a digital signature. This is really, really a remarkable idea. I would love to see this implemented in the U.S., but maybe I'll just get an Estonian card and leave it at that.
The whole point is I don't think it will work in countries like Britain or America because we have a very ingrained distrust of our authorities, which is probably right, because they screw things up all the time.
Right.
I would be horrified about having a British digital ID because I'd be afraid that there'll be a CD-ROM, probably not even a thumb drive, with everybody's details.
Left flying around,
Someone would leave it on a train. But I do trust the Estonians. And actually, the Singaporeans love this idea, and the Singaporeans are thinking of doing this idea for the whole of East Asia, because people know that Singapore is a very well-run country. But I think it's like credit cards. I have a MasterCard, I have a Visa,
I have
American
Express.
I think we'll have competing markets in strong digital identities, and people say, well, I like this one. Yeah, there's no reason why American Express couldn't do one for that matter, or Visa or MasterCard or anybody else.
I'm applying right now.
Okay.
Let's talk about David Cameron.
Do we have to?
I'm curious where you stand on this whole encryption thing. And I'm also curious what's really going on, because I saw the debate in the House of Lords in which they said, no, we have no plans to put backdoors in encryption. And yet it seems as if that's exactly the plan, and the rhetoric certainly, from your prime minister.
Well, I think that he's had a reality check, to be honest. I think that the original idea, both in the United States and in the UK...
Yes, I'm not blaming you, because, of course, you've said the same thing.
That we don't have any no-go areas in our real-world life. You know, I wouldn't be allowed to say, I have a room in my house which is so strong that even if you have a search warrant, you can't get in, because that might be where I was keeping my prisoners, and the law enforcement would want to get in there.
Right.
And so an analogous idea, if you come from a kind of law enforcement background, is we shouldn't have no-go areas in the online world either. So therefore, if there's encryption, you have to give a key to every room in your house, or we break the door down. You have to give key to everything in your digital life, or we break the door down. But actually, we can't break the door down because it would need all the computers in the world running for the lifetime of the universe, and we still won't get in. So therefore, you've got to have a key. And there isn't a key. So what are we going to do? Well, we ban you from using that. Well, unfortunately, that just doesn't work, because you only have to be moderately technically sophisticated, you can install PGP, or you can use Proton Mail, or you can use any number of third-party encrypted apps. And it's no good them going to Apple or Google and saying, give us the key, because there isn't a key. And so I think they've realized that they're just going to have to get at these targets in other ways. You know, you can do what they call endpoint. You know, they can go for endpoint vulnerabilities. They can put stuff on your keyboard and stuff that reads your screen. They can put a pinhole camera in the wall behind you and read that way. They have ways of doing this. They just can't do it the way they used to do it when nobody used encrypted communications. Now, to some extent, I'm sad because I don't want the bad guys to have a leg up. But on the other hand, I think strong cryptography is one of the few things we've got that works. We need it for banking, for shopping, for all sorts of other things. And the idea of giving the authorities a key to every front door in the world and hoping they look after them sensibly is crazy. So therefore, we can't do it. And that's why the government's dropped it.
So they have dropped it.
They're putting a duty on internet companies to help, but they're not saying they're not trying to prohibit strong encryption, because you can't. It's like trying to prohibit people raiding.
Well, and doing so in the UK would have two negative impacts. One, it would make it very difficult for a lot of companies to do business in the UK, and secondly, it would really unilaterally weaken our protection worldwide, because of course, if you've got to put a backdoor in your encryption, it's going to be for everybody.
Exactly. I mean, what would happen is you would have a lot of people. I think we shouldn't waste time talking about this, actually, because it simply isn't going to happen.
It's a non-starter. Okay.
And, they finally persuaded the politicians this is a technical non-starter for reasons both of the maths behind cryptography and the incompetence of government and the fact that other products are available, and everyone will just go to, you know, stuff that's made in Iceland where you can't, you know, there's nothing the government can do about it.
Exactly. Right. More about cyberphobia just a bit. I want to tell you about something so exciting. And I want to just pat these guys on the back. Because you know what? I think Epson deserves a pat on the back because they've listened to us. And they've listened to us about the high price of inkjet ink. They've listened to us about the inconvenience of, you know, running out of ink halfway through a print shop. And they've created the new EcoTank printers. And this is exactly what I wanted. This is exactly what you want. First of all, these are great printers. There's a whole line of EcoTank printers. They're all based on Epson's amazing state-of-the-art precision core technology. We're talking on my precision core printer, 2 or 3 seconds a page. It goes and it's done. And does it look good? 40 million drops of ink, 40 million drops of ink per second gives you not only fast printing, but super crisp, laser-quality black text, vivid colors. You get all the great features of this all-in-one printer, like auto two-sided printing, 30-page auto document feeder, which really works, by the way, and easy wireless printing from tablets and smartphones. It supports AirPrint. It supports Google Cloud Print. It's exactly the printer you want. And, yes, it comes with all this ink in the box. The EcoTank ET4550, good example, doesn't use ink cartridges. Instead, it has a refillable ink tank with enough ink to print up to 8,500 pages, color pages. That's about 50 ink cartridge sets. That's 2 years of printing. If you print a lot, that is awesome. And then when you need to refill it, ultra-low-cost replacement ink bottles. They've just taken the pain out of inkjet printing, and I just love these guys. They deserve all praise. We got to support them because they did the right thing. Epson.com/EcoTank. I have a precision core printer, and I bought it just before Epson came out with EcoTank, so I'm going to go back to the store and buy a new one. Epson.com/EcoTank. It will transform the way your home, your office, your workgroup prints. For the best combination of ease and value, turn to the new Epson EcoTank printers, EPSON.com/EcoTank. And we thank Epson so much for their support. Epson, exceed your vision. This is fun. We're talking to Edward Lucas of The Economist. Do you cover this now in The Economist as well?
I do. I'm one of our guys. I wrote a piece last week, in fact, on cybersecurity called The Cost of Immaturity, looking at the way in which the cybersecurity industry was developing very fast. Unfortunately, it went to press just before the FireEye share price collapsed, because that would have been a great peg. My sign-off was that maybe investors are getting a bit more skeptical about how much these companies are really worth. Maybe customers are getting a bit choosy about what they buy. And if FireEye's price had gone down 6 hours previously, that would have been very handy, but it didn't. But anyway, so I was more prescient than I knew.
Well, I have to say, The Economist is one of the last great news weeklies in the world. It's really a must read for anybody who doesn't read it. There are digital versions as well.
Indeed, I edit our daily news app, which is called Espresso, which is unlike any other news app. It doesn't tell you what happened yesterday. Well, it does in brief, but what it really does is tell you what's going to happen today. And that comes out, you can get it on Android and on Apple. It's a freemium model. You get one bit free, and then otherwise you subscribe through iTunes. And we have huge number of subscribers. It's growing very fast. I absolutely love editing it, and I'd recommend it to anyone who's watching this program.
You know, this is a challenge. This is completely off the topic, but I think a great topic for you. For all media that was print media, I look at what the New York Times did this past Sunday in the United States. They sent out Google Cardboard and encourage people to watch immersive video, 360-degree video, about the displaced children of war, which I thought was very experimental. The Times has been very experimental. The Economist has also been a thought leader in digital. This move, though, is fraught with peril, isn't it?
Yes. First of all, we're still making loads of money from print. We have 1.6 million subscribers. A lot of them love it. My brother-in-law has been a subscriber, same age as me, been a subscriber since his teens. He carries it around with him. I don't think he's ever going to go into a digital version. So we have an extremely valuable, loyal, enthusiastic subscriber base who are just wedded to paper. And that's great. The problem with paper for us is we have to buy the paper and the ink and pay the printers, and that's a lot of atoms. And, you know, if we sell it as an electron product, that's a lot cheaper for us. So we are very happy to have digital subscribers, although we are also delighted we've still got so many print ones. And there are many people indeed who subscribe to both. They have both the print version because they'd like to have it lying around the house, and they also like the electronic version because they can carry it around with them on their digital device and read it on their computer and tweet it and do stuff like that.
We'll have some final words with Edward Lucas in just a bit. Actually, I want to talk about what we can do about this, what the future holds. But first, I want to tell you what my future dinner holds. Blue Apron, our Blue Apron box just outside. I have it delivered here. You can have it delivered to your house, to your business. You can arrange it. What is it? It is a refrigerated box containing exactly the ingredients you need to make an amazing dinner tonight. I have a long work day. I won't be done till 6 today, but I don't want to go shopping, but I want to have a nice dinner. I don't have to worry. Everything I need, no waste, by the way, exactly the amount I need, plus a recipe card that step-by-step with beautiful pictures describes how to do it. You can even go online if there's techniques you want to learn. They have videos at blueapron.com/twit. And the meals are amazing. And by the way, not expensive. You might say, oh, that's going to cost me a lot. This is Jason making lamb and beef shawarma, which is one of my favorite all-time things. Everything is fresh. The produce comes from local farms, peak of freshness. The meat is fresh, not frozen. It's a refrigerated box. And it is delicious. About a little less than $10 per meal. So you're getting a great deal. And these are fresh, healthy ingredients, about, 500 to 700 calories a portion. They have family plans for larger groups, kid-friendly ingredients. You can plan your menu ahead of time if you want. You go on the site and say, I don't want this, I do want that. You'll never see the same recipe twice. So it really expands your repertoire. Not just for your kids, it expands the repertoire of things they eat. For you, it expands the repertoire of things you can make and eat. And boy, you'll be discovering amazing stuff. How about seared steaks and sage brown butter with cauliflower, beet, and apple hash? See, it's, you know, I can do the steak, but the sage brown butter and cauliflower, beet, and apple hash, see, I wouldn't ever even think of that. Trattoria-style cheeseburgers. This must be the kids' menu. Seared chicken and roasted sweet potato. North African spice shrimp and couscous. Yeah, baby! How about coconut curry braised cauliflower? This is for the vegetarians. Yeah, they have vegetarians. Coconut curry braised cauliflower with aromatic basmati rice and cilantro chutney. Mary Jo Foley's a vegetarian. She loves to cook. We sent her a Blue Apron. She loved it. Now, of course, you can have meat with every meal, too. You get to choose. But you'll also be cooking, I think this is cool, with ingredients you've never used before. We found a new bok choy, a bok choy variant, in one of our, I think it was the 3-cup Taiwanese chicken. And it was incredible. And I only buy that now. Watermelon radishes? What's farro? I don't know. You will find out when you cook with it, with your Blue Apron box. Purple potatoes? Kids love those. It's delicious. It's good for you. You don't have to worry about shopping. And it's inspiring. This is inspiring. That's the thing I love about it. Get your first two meals free. Find out for yourself. BlueApron.com/twit. Catfish po' boy sandwiches. Thai chicken meatball curry. Or fall vegetable and goat cheese quiche. Seared steaks. That's the seared steaks one. Oh, you're making me hungry. You shouldn't do this at lunchtime. BlueApron.com/twit. We thank them so much for their support. And we encourage you to try it. At least get those first two meals free. BlueApron.com/twit. We're talking with Edward Lucas, senior editor at The Economist, and I've just learned the editor of The Economist Espresso app, which is an app for Android and iOS that tells you, in your wonderful words, Edward, not what happened yesterday, but what's going to happen today. The book is a really kind of page-turning description of many of the kind of incidents, some old, some new, that you have all been following, I know, on Twit and in Security Now. I think we should probably wrap this up by asking if you have a prescription. I mean, obviously, we have gone full speed ahead. In fact, I think you quote in 1998 the director of the CIA saying, "We've gone full bore into technologies which we do not know how to." Here it is: we are staking our future on a resource we have not yet learned how to protect. What do we do?
Well, I think. The first thing to understand, there's no magic bullet. You know, anyone who says, just plug this thing into your computer and you'll be safe, is selling snake oil.
Yeah.
So there are many necessary conditions, but no sufficient ones. One of them is, I think we need identity assurance. We need to be able, as I just talked about, we need to be able to prove who we are and prove who other people are so we can interact with them. That's number one. Number two is we need to understand about navigation. That at the moment, the system of security certificates is basically broken. It's really easy to mislead people so they think they're on a safe website and they're not, with all sorts of different techniques, man-in-the-middle attacks and so on. So we need to do a much better job in internet navigation, just as we know physically, if we're going to a bad area, we should be taking precautions. We should have, and that's tricky. And I genuinely don't know what the answer is. I think it probably lies with the people who make browsers have to be much better at warning us when we're using a browser to navigate. But even that won't work because we don't only use browsers when we go on the internet. But there's a really serious navigation problem which we need to work on. Then we need to understand that there are no technical sole technical fixes. Is fundamentally about the way we behave. We've got to deal with the millions and millions of people with out-of-date legacy systems. So even if we started right now with trustworthy software and properly made devices and ran everything the way we ran the space shuttle, which is one of the few examples of really high-end trustworthy software, even then we've got all this sort of broken stuff around which we're living with. And I think the best way of thinking about this is road safety. That when I grew up in the United Kingdom, we had 6,500 people a year being killed on the roads. Now it's under 2,000. And we did this not with any sort of single magic bullet, but by very simple education. Speed kills. Slow down. Don't drink and drive. Clunk click every trip, which is put your seatbelt on. We put a lot of money into things like baby on board. Another sort of classic thing. We put money into redesigning our road system, so we got rid of dangerous junctions. We redesigned cars so that when you're hit by a car, the damage is done to the car, not to the person. So we put commercial pressure, so it became, if you produce dangerous cars, you lost customers, shareholders worried. We had regulatory pressure. We basically attacked this from every direction. I think that's what we need to do with this. So whether it's a credit rating agency saying, we're not going to give you a AAA rating because we think your cyber security is bad and that's going to be a credit event. It may be shareholders saying, I don't want to bite you, I don't want to buy and hold these shares anymore. It could be the insurance companies saying, we're not going to insure you because you've got all this Wi-Fi enabled stuff and it can blow up any moment. Whether it's the government saying you have to share information on breaches, or if you do share information, we're not going to hit you with antitrust laws. It's
We just passed that bill in the United States.
It's gone through the Senate. We're waiting for it to come into law. But
you support that bill. I mean, that was a very controversial bill among internet privacy and freedom advocates.
There's a real problem here that if you have a if you've given your information to a company and you gave it because you wanted it to be private and the company's breached and then they give it to the government, you say, hey, I didn't want that to go to the government. So I think that the key thing is to share the how. It's not so important to share the what. but I think we need to have do much better job in sharing. How did it get onto the network? What was the payload? What was it trying to do? Because if we share this stuff, then we are beginning to match the criminals who are sharing it all the time. I think that it's probably I would say it was an imperfect solution, but probably better than nothing. It's still in conference now. And I know your system works absolutely brilliantly, and Washington is renowned for finding, for moving speedly in pursuit of the common good in an extremely pragmatic and non-ideological way. So nothing can possibly go wrong now. It's between the House and the Senate, and then it'll go to the White House, and then someone will sign it, and then we'll see. So I follow that with interest. But there's no legislative magic bullet to this, but I do think we need to give our director of GCHQ, Robert Hannigan, is giving the speech tomorrow. Here I am, espresso, telling what's going to happen tomorrow. And he's going to say in this speech, market forces have failed. We've tried leaving it to the market. It hasn't worked. We still have far too few companies that take this seriously. And the result is the criminals are running riot. So we need some kind of regulatory and legislative pressure, which scares people in the C-suite who don't really understand this, would much rather not spend the money and much rather not have to re-engineer their businesses, and make them think, if I get this wrong, the company goes bust and I might even go to jail and everybody will hate me. And those three things of the criminal justice system, commercial pressure, and social censure, that can make a difference. But we're not there yet.
Well, and in the United States, it is much more tricky because, of course, as you pointed out, we don't trust government. We have a long and cherished history of malfeasance. I don't know if this is really a soluble problem, to be honest with you.
Well, crime is never fully soluble. We have to manage the risk from criminals, from hostile nation states, from spies, from hooligans, pranksters. Life's full of ups and downs, but what we try and do is not have a single point of vulnerability. We try and make sure that the penalties are sufficient to deter people. The malefactors worry about getting caught. That we try and have some sort of penalties for carelessness. And we fix this with public health. Americans don't trust their government. That's right. And America exists because you didn't trust the government when it was our government. So that's fine. A healthy disrespect for government is a great thing. But you still have strong public health laws. And if I have multi-drug resistant tuberculosis or Ebola or something, I can't walk down the street. I will, People will in spacesuits will grab me and take me to an isolation unit because I'm a danger, not just to myself, but to other people. And that will happen even in Texas. So we do have ways of thinking about individual actions that have massive externalities, massive costs on other people. And I think the internet's a bit like that. If I do something that's incredibly risky and irresponsible, if I have a if I have a server, which is part of a botnet, is spewing out spam all over the internet and, doing all sorts of damage, well, I can't simply just say, that's my computer and I'll do what I want with it. That's doing damage to other people.
Yeah, I think the public health model is an excellent model for this, really.
Yeah. There's plenty of analogies, but none of them's perfect.
Right.
I say hastily.
Just in case. I want to thank you because you have to go to dinner and we have to wrap up the show. I wish we had more time with you. I've already downloaded, installed, and paid for Economist Espresso because I want to know what's going to happen tomorrow. Edward Lucas not only edits that, he's a senior editor at The Economist and the author of a new book called Cyberphobia, which I think is challenging and exciting and interesting, and it just happens to be a real page-turner too. So that's a nice bonus. It's not a dry book by any means. It's a book full of fascinating anecdotes and stories and some really interesting conclusions. Mr. Lucas, thank you so much for your time. I hope you'll come back soon.
Leo, this was just such a pleasure. I really enjoyed it very much indeed. And I'm on Twitter. I'm at Edward Lucas. And if anyone wants to reach out to me, as you say over there, and tell me I'm wrong or underline or query anything I've said, I'd be delighted to engage them on social media. Other networks are also available.
Fantastic. Yeah. And a little Schubert at the end. Do you want to play a little note or two? No, that's all right. Thank you.
My daughter's upstairs doing her homework, I'm afraid.
Good girl. Thank you, Mr. Lucas, for your time. We appreciate it.
Bye-bye.
And I thank you all for joining us on Triangulation. Always a provocative and fascinating discussion. Actually, I want to get Mr. Lucas back and talk about Snowden, because he has somewhat of a contrarian view, I think, to a lot of us. So I'd like to hear more about that. But meanwhile, the book Cyberphobia is available from Bloomsbury Press. And From the parts I've read, I just got it yesterday or the day before. So the parts I've read, it is really fascinating. We do Triangulation every Monday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern time. That's 1900 UTC on twit.tv. Watch live. Join us in the chat room. Your questions are valuable. They really help me direct the conversation. But if you can't, on-demand versions are always available too after the fact at twit.tv/TRI or wherever you get your internet broadcasts, iTunes, of course, and all the other podcast apps. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time on Triangulation.